Saxena, Professor Rohit Saxena. He's a strabismologist and neuro-ophthalmologist at RP Center Ames, and he'll be teaching us about interpretation of pattern and flash VEP. Sir.
So thank you very much, Neha, for making me a part of this, and of course AIOS. You would have seen two things ad nauseum. One, that none of these investigations give you anything more than just an idea, and clinical acumen, understanding, a lot of chair time, and of course putting everything together is key. And of course the other thing you would have noticed, that you know, always the neuro ophthalmologist and the retina guys will always be clashing one way or the other. So I also have a couple of retina guys who don't believe that I have more retina patients coming in the neuro ophthalmology clinic, and they have a lot more diagnosis of neuro ophthalmology cases, because as was mentioned, temporal pallor is very, very important for the retina guy, but for the neuro ophthalmologist is just one of those, you know, things, suggestions that we see. So again, as Neha had started off from the very beginning, all these things are connected to each other. So a temporal pallor is merely a reflection that the nerve fibers that are the ganglion cell layer that are going to synapse at the lateral geniculate body and then go onwards to the occiput are all connected, and any change or damage at any one of the places here may give rise to a temporal pallor, and therefore you have to look at both the retina and the optic nerve whenever you have a dysfunction of anything, and particularly VER. So we'll just talk a bit about basic VER. I think most of us know enough to practically use it, and the rest we'll see on cases. So essentially it is measuring visual field potential during cortical processing in response to a retinal stimulation. So we saw the retinal responses happening to a light stimulus as the light is transduced from light to an electric stimulus in ERGs that we were seeing, and then as they move on and they are processed in the occiput and put a shape is brought to them. So that's what we are measuring. It's therefore the integrity of the visual pathway from the retina, essentially being the ganglion cell layer, to the occipital cortex, and the electrodes are over the scalp and reference electrodes. We have a flash VEP, which uses a flash of light as the stimulus, and a pattern VEP that uses the checkerboard, and it would be the test of choice for optic nerve lesions up to the chiasma. So we'll talk about the flash VEP first, which is less sensitive. It is highly variable across the population, so there would be huge variations in its response. But the key things that help us are that it is low asymmetry. So even slight asymmetry between the eyes would help us to localize that there is some issues, some true issues happening in the optic nerve. And users would be suspected functional non-organic pathology also. So a normal VEP in the presence of visual loss, you would not necessarily keep going in for expensive neurological or neuroradiological investigations. And a flash VEP reduces the chance of not seeing or poor cooperation. So the flash is so bright that even if he closes the eyes, you will get a fairly good response. And the problem with the pattern, any pattern, whether it's for ERG or for VEP, is this, that if the patient is not looking at it, then the responses may not be as accurate. So it's a series of negative positive peaks with significant variability, and N2 and P2 are the most robust responses, and that's why they are taken for measuring the amplitude and the latency. And of course, it's a little age dependent, because we know that in infants, the myelination process in the brain takes a little while to develop. So it may be 6 months or more before which even a reasonable amount of myelination has happened, and therefore the VEP response may be poor or muted. And actually that is why the reason that the child in infancy or in 2, 3, 4 months of age may present with the parent saying that the child does not see. So if everything else is normal, then we would wait for a while and maybe hope that it's just for that, because of the delayed myelination process. And a delayed flash VEP would probably help us to expect that it is because of delayed myelination, although it is not again always true. A pattern VEP, majority of P100 response is due to the central 8 to 10 degree. So it's a central response that we are getting, and there is very little intra or inter observer variability. But because of the importance of being able to see the pattern and resolve those changing color, changing pattern. It can be affected by refractive error, degree of arousal, attention, of course, retinal pathologies, and malingerers who may actually defocus or not actually look at the target. So increase in P100 latency is the evidence of visual pathway dysfunction. It is the most reliable abnormality and would not be really affected by technical or patient factors. It is suggestive of an optic nerve dysfunction only. So it is not necessarily pathognomonic of optic neuritis, a kind of thing that you often see. So a report would say that increased latency, optic neuritis. So they don't just go together, because there are the latency itself may be increased in compressions, in macular dysfunction, in Parkinson's. So a lot of conditions may have an increase in the latency, but the by numbers and usually the most likely diagnosis would be an optic neuritis, whether it's because of demyelination or any other cause, but because of the transmission is slower. So we'll just run through a few cases and try and understand what is the clinical utility of this. So a 32-year-old female came with complaints of sudden loss of vision in the right eye 4 days back. There is a mild pain in ocular movements. There is a subnormal vision you can see. There is a right afferent pupillary defect. The bold RAPD is that even before you go into electrophysiology, an RAPD is a very, very sensitive sign of optic nerve dysfunction. So even before you're looking for VEPs, even subtle, slight relative afferent pupillary defects in patients with a 6x6 vision or an nearly equal vision in both the eyes would tell you that there is an early optic nerve dysfunction happening. The fundus was unremarkable. So how would you diagnose? I mean, how would you say definitely that this is there is an optic nerve dysfunction? So in these cases, a VEP can help, especially if you're thinking that there are you are not sure whether you want to start IV methylprednisolone or not. So an increase in latency is, in such clinical setting, very, very helpful or suggestive that it's an optic neuritis. Another 31-year-old male, sudden loss of vision in the right eye, subnormal vision you can see in the right eye. In the left eye also, there was a little subnormal vision. A right afferent pupillary defect, we diagnosed as a retrobulbar neuritis. Again, a visual evoked potential was done. It's important again, because in this case, because the other eye was showing subtle visual defects, again, you can see that the left subclinical involvement is there and is something that you will pick up in a lot of optic neuritis cases. So while we say typical optic neuritis is unilateral, but we know that subclinical involvement of the other eye can be there. So slight changes in the VEP in the other eye may not be unusual, and in fact may be something you may often see. The other thing that on follow-up, the vision was 6x6, there was the visual acuity at least was absolutely normal, although these patients may complain that their quality of vision is not as good, and that is what you will see reflected in the latency, that you can see the latency is still increased. So although visual acuity is normal, the entire visual functions have not been restored. But just to say that the electrophysiological changes may take much longer, 6 months up to a year or more, to come back to normal. VEP in multiple sclerosis, we have seen, and now it's quite established, that even in cases of multiple sclerosis who do not have any history or evidence of optic nerve involvement have an increase in the VEP. And also that VEP can be, as we said, significantly affected in those patients who have only a unilateral presentation. So affected VEP in cases of multiple sclerosis without history of optic neuritis may be showing that there is subclinical involvement. In fact, there is a lot of evidence now that is showing significant OCT changes in these patients of MS which do not have any history of optic neuritis. And the fact that OCT changes are happening, backed by the fact that they do have electrophysiological changes, means that while clinical changes are not happening, but subclinically the optic nerve is getting involved. Unfortunately, the VEP is no more a part of the diagnostic criteria for multiple sclerosis, but considering that it's a very, very sensitive test to pick up white matter changes, it should be, and at least it may help in cases when we are monitoring the effect of or the impact of intervention that is now coming in, and a lot of intervention that is there. So to stress that MRIs and OCTs demonstrate only the structure, and the function is provided by the VEP for the optic nerve, and therefore they have a definite role in following up patients. Another, an interesting case This was a 24-year-old male patient, came to us with history of trauma on the right forehead with sudden loss of vision in the left eye. Traumatic mydriasis with the left, you could see the left divergent squint. Now, actually, initially, I had not noticed the left divergent squint, and he just came, walked into us, and there was a clear trauma here, but he was definite loss of vision in the left eye. And for a while, initially, I thought that the resident is presenting me the vision wrong, or I thought he may actually be a case of malingering because he's not remembering which side of the head he has trauma. But is it really traumatic optic neuropathy? And you can see the visual evoke, this is an absolute flat line. So there is optic nerve injury on this side. And of course, the interesting thing was the CT. You can see the trauma was here on the right side, and it spared the left optic nerve, optic canal, and went and damaged the right side. So it can help us particularly when we are not sure. This is a 30-year-old female who came to us with progressive loss of vision. She was diagnosed as atrophic papilledema. She had very, very poor vision, hand movements. The neurologists were pressing that go ahead and do an optic nerve fenestration. We were not very keen because we didn't feel the outcomes would be really very good. But the VEP showed us some waveforms, and young female, we were kind of very aggressive in operating. We operated, and over time you can see that the waveforms are now better, and she was actually 6/18 both eyes. So it can help to tell us that there was some visual function which we could help to restore. A case of 24-year-old patient on ATT, ethambutol particularly, 6/18 vision, ethambutol toxicity or not. You need to know that tuberculosis can cause damage to the optic nerves of brain in multiple ways. So whether we go in for imaging to see for disseminated TB or we are thinking of ethambutol toxicity, again, the flash was not significantly affected, but you look at the pattern, there was severely affected pattern VEP suggesting of toxicity. So again, important to remember, pattern VEP is the most sensitive sign to detect early toxicity. And I think this is the last case, 1-year-old child, not recognizing mother, unaffected by visual stimuli. You can see the optic nerves are a little pale, but not all that bad. So the parents were asking, can my child see? As I said, the VEP was essentially no response. We couldn't see anything. But over time, this does develop, and that's what happened. Over time, the VEPs also came back, and the child was able to see some, although probably not normal vision. So delayed myelination or damage to the brain during the time of birth are things that we can anticipate a pickup when we are doing an electrophysiological test. So the other thing, of course, hysteria and malingering, VEP would be normal, but remember, patient may not fixate on stimuli or close the eyes. And abnormal VEP in a patient labeled as hysteria, please investigate, that may not be what it is. Clinically, optic nerve disease, measuring visual acuity in infants, so VEPs are also used to measure visual acuity or estimate using pattern VEPs to diagnose malingering and hysteria or rule out an organic pathology, visual potentials in opaque media like very dense cataracts, and of course, unexplained visual loss. Thank you all, and I'll just take Neha's indulgence to invite you all to the third neuro-ophthalmology conference that we'll have on 29th, 30th of August at RP Center, AIIMS, New Delhi. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Anybody has any comments or questions?
I just wanted to ask
questions. In your lab, what's the upper limit of your normal implicit? So we take up to 110 depending upon milliseconds, depending upon the setting, but 100 would be our normal. So 90 to 100 would be normal, but depending upon the clinical setting, like we would say that a very young child, or we feel that there are issues. So for pattern, it would be definitely 100, 90 to 100. For flash, we would take up to 110.
So with this, we finish on barely on time. We were given the hall late, but I thank all the audience for being with us. I thank all the co-instructors. I thank Dr. Ranjana, our keynote speaker, and I hope everybody benefited from our course. And if we can just have the faculty for a picture, please.